being up about the Father's business. There's people that have needs in their life, and Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he heals one body today, he can heal two.
Amen.
Fact of business is, it was took care of at Calvary.
Amen.
Remember the Lord and forget not his benefits. We're just taking hold of that he's purchased for us, made possible for us. He said it's finished. It's finished.
Amen.
We've got to seek him wholeheartedly and release your faith to have to receive something from him.
Amen.
Faith is not something that you can brag about. It comes through hearing the word and believing the word, knowing that God is God, believing that he is a rewarder.
Amen.
He loves us. He cares for us. He's mindful of us. You can't imagine the love of God reaching out to a lost and dying world. You can't imagine Jesus going through what he did and praying for the people that was abusing him and putting him to death. That's a love beyond what we can imagine. But we need to be open-hearted and open-minded and have a love and compassion one for another. Jesus said, this is my commandment that you love one another.
Amen.
Whoa, glory to God.
Amen.
We must have that. The disciples was called Christian first at Antioch because they was Christ-like. What was different about this man Christ? He had a love and a compassion. Instead of saying, stone him, he said, go and sin no more.
Amen.
Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more.
Amen.
Get out of the sinning business and claim the victory through Jesus Christ, and we can have it.
Amen.
Oh, glory to God.
Amen.
Jesus was a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief, went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil.
Amen.
All that was oppressed. Satan's oppressing people.
Yes, he is.
He's trying to push people around, and he will if you'll let him. And sometimes you just got to plead the blood and use the word.
Amen.
Glorify and praise the Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Resist him and he'll flee from you. As long as you stick out your hand and say, my old author, writers, or my old this, or my old that. Listen, it's not yours. You were the whole of it, who said. We're made whole through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Glory to God. We're going to pray if I can hush, but I tell you, God is God.
Amen.
He is real, and he's here tonight, and he's your God if you'll allow him to be.
Amen.
Glory Amen. To God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Brother Mike, if you can't preach tonight, you're in bad shape. Preacher's here. He's here.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Believe him right now. He
Amen.
Is a rewarder. Glory to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, your mercy, your power. We thank you for every blessing of life. Lord, we believe that you're mindful of the need of this congregation. Lord, we believe you went forward and had a love and a compassion and met the needs of those about you. Lord, Heavenly Father, we believe it tonight that you've taken care of this service. We believe you'll bless this people, rich, helpless, and touch us, Lord. Fill us up, help us to be strong in the Lord. Glory to God. Lord, we bless you. Your will to be done. Saturated the Lord this ministry tonight with the Holy Ghost of God. We bless the Lord. The anointed. Hallelujah.
Oh.
Hallelujah. Let the Holy Ghost have his way in this place tonight. Lord
Amen.
God, we believe you have miracles that we can't imagine.
While you're standing up, go shake hands with about 50 people. Amen.
for everybody. Come on out to that. Saturday, September 19th, from 7 to 2. We also have a special Men of Action community-wide fellowship. This is an interdenominational men's fellowship. And they're going to be meeting September 15th, 2015, at 6:30 p.m. down at the Mason's Barn on 140 Colonial Way, Dalton, Georgia, 30721. If you want to find out some more information about that, there's another follow-up because it will be out in the hall at the resource table following service. We're going to have special musical guest, Brother Chris McDaniel. He's the former member of the Confederate Revolution. This is the interdenominational men's fellowship meeting September 15th, 2015. Amen. I also want to remind everybody this upcoming September 20th at 6 p.m., we're going to have the next live City View Gospel Music Singing right here at City View at 6 p.m. We're going to have special guest Dana Russell, the Burns family, Brother Trevor Warnix, and the City View Praise Team will be administering song and worship. So come on out to that. Invite everybody you know. Also, September 29th at 7 p.m. is the Overcomers Outreach 1 year anniversary, and we're going to have door prizes and refreshments, special music provided by the City View Praise Team. Have a great time with the Lord. We have a lot of stuff going on here at City View. I'd also like to remind our deacons, this is just in, this is a new announcement. Sunday, September 20th at 4:30 p.m., we will be meeting on September 20th at 4:30 p.m. I'd like to say a continued thank you to each and every one of you tonight for your support of the food pantry ministry. We're in specific need of donations of canned tuna. Anything and everything you give towards that ministry goes 100% back into five families that we helped today because of your generosity. So give glory to the Lord. Amen. I'll ask everybody to stand tonight. We'll receive the offering tonight, and we'll ask our ushers to come forward. Go ahead, sister. September 19th at CBS at what time, sister? Okay. September 19th at CBS is a special fundraiser to help Sister Megan Madden. Amen. Let's do whatever we can to help her. Amen. Brother Eric, if you'd be so kind to say a blessing over tonight's offering.
Brother Trevor Warnix. Y'all give him a great big hand, Trevor. Amen.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises. Cause living he loved me, dying.
Next singer is going to be Pure Heart. Come on, guys. Y'all give them a great big hand. Amen. Thank you.
Yeah.
Have a father who can. Amen. Come on, Brother Mike. Brother Michael Blaylock gonna preach for us tonight. Y'all give him a great big hand. You can get to know him. And I'm thankful that tonight I can say that I know my Father. And I probably had an opportunity to over prepare. We was off church last Sunday, and then we had the revival and everything, and it was great. How many enjoyed the revival? Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I know I always enjoy Brother Corey and what the Lord's doing for him in his life, and it's a joy to see him prosper in the Lord the way that he has. And, you know, through the revival, I was praying, you know, that the Lord would move for the people and everything, and I had been praying about different things with myself. And the Lord prompted me and just it over and over rested in my heart, more or less. Said, you can't be the Christian that everybody else thinks you should be. I was like, what, Lord? Think about it, church. You can't be the Christian that I think you should be. I can't be the Christian that you think I should be. And the only thing we should be worried about is being the Christian that He's called us to be. Amen? That's where our main focus should be when it comes to teaching, preaching, singing. It's not about if... are they going to like it? Are they going to enjoy it? But that's the places that the devil will take our minds to get us off the focus of what He's called us to do. Jesus has called each and every one of us for a purpose.
whether it may be just being the leader of your household or being a witness for someone on your job. There's so many different things that the devil will use as tactics to bring our focus off the work that the Lord has for us. Church, it's time for us to get focused. It's time to not let our expectation be taken from us. How many goes through your daily life in an expectation of knowing the Lord has your back? Amen. You have that expectation of knowing when you get down on your knees and you pray out to God that He's going to answer. Amen. We've got to have that, church. It doesn't matter if He takes our car, if He takes our home, if He takes our health. As long as the devil cannot get your expectation, you will succeed. Amen. You know, we see on the news all of these different things about, you know, Christians more or less just being slaughtered. Amen. Have you thought about it if that was you? I'm sure you have. If you haven't, give it a thought for a minute. Give it a thought for longer than a minute, because it might be something that keeps you on your toes, that helps as a tool to form you into the Christian that the Lord's called you to be. Because we read about many different examples, and they face that same scrutiny. You know, I was reading a little bit this afternoon, and I was reading on Isaiah. And you know, he was actually, the way he was put to death, he was put between two boards and sawed in half. That's biblical, us. Promise you, put between two boards and sawed in half because of the prophecies that he had wrote about were being fulfilled. That's where we're becoming to again, church. That's where we are in our society, being scrutinized. We can't be conformed to this world. We can't. Amen. I don't know why I said all that, because that has nothing to do with anything where I'm going that I know of. But I prayed and I told the Lord that I was His. And I'd like to ask Brother Nathan to stand and pray over the reading of this word, and just give the Lord this service, Nathan. Thank you, Lord. All right, I want to ask everybody to turn to the book of John in chapter 2. And I pray that I'm able to give this to you as the Lord give it to me. And I actually started looking at these scriptures. I mean, I've read it many a times, I'm sure you have. In chapter 2, starting at verse 1, you know, about Jesus' first miracle, where he turns the water into wine, the marriage in Cana of Galilee. I read this several times in the past, and like I said, about 6 months ago, I started actually studying it a little bit. You know, because I really wondered how John... He went from telling us, you know, exactly what God was. You know, he was, you know, about Jesus. And in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And, you know, he just drives that point through the whole chapter. And then we get to chapter 2, and Jesus is at a wedding. He's at a marriage celebration. And so I started looking at Jewish tradition and marriage and everything. And before I go any further, I want to tell you what I learned about how they celebrated and why this was going on. They don't celebrate a wedding the way we do. It might go on for a week, 2 weeks, because they actually look at it as, and it's exactly what it is. It's two families coming together, and it's what's theirs is yours, and everybody shares and borrows, and kind of like it used to be when I was a little kid, when my mom would need a cup of sugar, and she would send me to Miss Espy's house and say, my mom told me to get a cup of sugar. You know, those kind of things. You don't hardly hear of that anymore. I know I don't. You know, some places where people live, you wouldn't send your kid to the neighbor's house regardless. But the Jewish tradition, they celebrated the family because it wasn't just about the two people. It was about the whole entire family. It was a celebration. Time to be celebrated and spend time together. And we'll start reading here in verse 1. And the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And through my studies, I learned that actually, you know, Mary was a friend to this family. And they were dear to her. And through her relationship, of course, this family had actually seen Jesus grow up. You know, where Jesus grew up, it wasn't too far away from Galilee. And they actually seen Jesus grow up and knew Mary and their family. So they were invited to come celebrate with them. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. You know, word had started spreading a little bit about Jesus. And, you know, I was thinking about this. You know, it says in the third verse, and when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no more wine. Think about it. This is tradition. You have wine, you celebrate. The person that's organizing this is, oh no, we're out of wine. That was what they had to drink. This was a celebration, a time of celebration. It's done went on for 3 days. But she comes to Jesus. She says, they have no wine. Jesus saith unto her, woman, what have I do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. He's more or less, he's saying, you know, woman, that was just a way of putting a little bit of separation there. It wasn't out of disrespect to his mother. It was kind of like saying, wait a minute, how is this my problem? But if you notice, Mary does not answer Jesus. She just moves right along. And she goes to the servants. His mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. She didn't answer Jesus' question about, hey, what am, you know, how is this my problem? Why do I need to fix this? You know, my time's not come. How many people here has that type of mother that she's not going to hear that, she's going to move right along to the next thing? Or how many just has friends that way? Few of us do. But the point that in the scripture that John was trying to make here, his mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. When Jesus referred to his mother, he says, woman, what have I to do with thee? This was a polite way, but a firm way to place distance between them, more or less say, how is this my problem? But because of her reputation that she had with him and the relationship. How many here today can say that you have a relationship with Jesus and you know that you can go to him and ask Him for whatever it is. And He cares for you. And He'll do everything He can to see that through. Amen? Do we have that type of relationship today? And how many times has the devil tried to lie to you and tell you that you don't? Well, that's what the Lord showed me through this. You know, but Mary knew her Jesus, her Son, would not let her down. Her faith told her this would be done. And then she moved right along to the servants. She knew that for God to do anything in an earthly realm, He had to do it through you and through me, the servants. That's us, church. We're the servants. Amen? She knew that Jesus was going to answer for what she asked for. That's faith. That's the kind of faith that we need to have. Ask Jesus for it and move right along. Keep about your Father's business. Amen? That's where we are today. Don't look to what's going on in the world. Be about your Father's business. Know when you pray for your child that's lost and out on drugs that one day he may be delivered and be preaching the Word of God. Who knows? Only Jesus knows. And if you ask for it, you should know it will be done. Amen? That's the kind of faith that we need to be working in today, church. Wavering not. This couldn't be the first miracle Jesus had done, but it was the first public miracle. Why would Mary have asked if she had never seen Jesus do anything? Think about it. When the Lord has given you a gift, and you at home in your bedroom, and you're practicing, or you're praising, and you're singing. You know, I'm sure Zach started at home in the bedroom praising, and his mom probably seen him before we did. Think about Jesus when he was at home. And he was praying to his Father. I'm sure Mary seen a few things before they started being recorded in this book. You know, what gift is hiding in you that you've not stepped out and functioned in? Amen? This couldn't be the first miracle. And why would Mary ask? And how many of us practiced in private and then someone pushes out into the open? You know, Mary come to him and just ask him and basically put him on the spot. Say, I need wine. She didn't sit and talk about it. She didn't sit and say, please, begged him or nothing. She just told him the situation, what the problem was, and moved right along. And that's where some of us need to come to. You've told Jesus your problem. Move right along. Believe what you're praying. Amen? That's where we're at today, church. It's time to believe what you're reading. Through faith, He'll set you free, church. Hallelujah. Let's get excited for Jesus. I told the Lord I was going to give Him all, and I'm going to give Him all. I don't mean to. I get excited. Amen? But it's time for us to stop listening to the devil hold us back. If the Lord's told you to step out all the way. You know, so many times you get up here to preach and you stay right here, and I'm speaking for myself, and you have to fight those thoughts of look at where you've been, look at what you've done. I know I'm not the only one. It's time, church, to step out. If you've asked for forgiving for it, it's under the blood. Amen. If there's somebody that you work with that you need to witness to, then witness to them. And if they start bringing up something you've done a year ago before you knew the Lord, or even if you did know the Lord, let them know about forgiveness. Amen. That's what the world needs to see a little more of. Instead of us as Christians keeping it all for ourselves, it's time for us to show others. It's what we're supposed to do. The devil wants us to keep it a secret. You know, the scriptures talk about our light being hid under a bushel. It's time to take that basket off of your head and let your words come out for the Lord. Speak to those that are lost and dying in this world. You know, as I read and I prayed about this, and how many of us are been blessed with something and it was a joy, like say our job, we was blessed with our job, and we went to work and it was a joy to go to. As an example, teaching school, and you looked in for nothing that anything. I just know my brother's a school teacher, and I'm using that as an example only. And you, it's a joy, and you go in for the first years, and it's just great. And then through life, it just seems more heavier and more heavier. And then eventually, you're just going through the motions. You're out of wine. You know, they run out of wine here. And you keep praying and asking Jesus and going through these motions. But you keep hanging on to the weights that has gotten a hold of you. Maybe you come to church and you say, well, it's just not the way that it used to be. I don't feel the way I used to. And you're just going through the motions. You're out of wine. And you start asking Jesus, hey, we need some wine, Lord. I'm talking about just asking Him, hey, Lord, why am I just feeling so weighed down? I'm still doing all the right things, saying all the right things, doing the right things, praying the right things. But you feel all weighted down, and you're out of wine. Are you following me, church? I'll get you there. It's all just a ritual. Well, let's move on to the scripture of the watering pots. His mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. And there were set 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. That's about 28 to 30 gallons apiece. With all 6 of those, that'd be 180 gallons of water that they would contain. That's a lot. And when those servants was told, they said, and he saith unto them, draw out. Well, a minute, I'm jumping ahead of myself. Verse 7. Jesus saith unto him, fill the water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. 180 gallons, church. 6 water pots. That's heavy. That took some time. And it didn't happen in one trip. It didn't happen by going to the well and just drawing 1 bucket of water out. They drew over and over and over to fill them up. And they're still back at the party waiting on the wine. You know, when you've been going to work every day, or you've been coming to church and being weighted down and asking the Lord, and you've been going through your ritual process, just as these water pots was used for here. See, it was a ritual for these water pots to be used for Jewish purification of washing of hands and feet before they went into another one's home, or before they sat down to feast with one another. And how many of us, we go to the well and we ask Jesus, and we just keep going on with the same thing and praying about the same thing. We've already said, oh Lord, I have faith. But we keep going to that well and drawing out and sending down that same prayer over and over and over. And it becomes a ritual. It's time for you to break your water pot and step out of the comfort zone. It's what the Lord is wanting the church to do today. Step out of your comfort zone. I'm more comfortable sitting on the pew over there letting Zach do all the praising. But I'm here tonight to say it's time for each of us to jump up and do our part, to step out of the comfort zone. It's time for us to exercise that expectation that I talked about and stop sending down the same prayer over and over and believe. I'm not saying it's wrong to pray. I pray, and I probably pray about the same thing 15 times before I finally let go of it and say, I'm not going to hang on to this no more. It's just as much for me as it is for you. But it comes a time to when we just have to say, Lord, it's yours, and walk away. And don't let it weigh you down anymore, church. Amen. Praise the Lord. And that's what the Lord's wanting for us today, is to believe His word and exercise our expectation. You know, as I said, we're still doing all the right things, but the thrill's gone. What do you do when your life has ran out of wine and you're just going through the motions? It's just a ritual. Going to church, something that was once a joy has become a ritual, and there you are at a wedding with no wine. It comes to a place to where you know. How many knows that a wedding is a representation of two people coming together as one through Christ? How many of us have had that situation and we've been married to it and we've let it hold us in the same place every week over? Over. I used to face situations all the time with my daughter. And when I finally let go of it and said, it's yours, Jesus. I'm not married to it anymore. The problem was solved. The very next week, I went to a meeting and shared how, with my brothers, how I was burdened and being burdened with this situation. I said, y'all pray about it for me. And I let it go. That was on a Tuesday. By Friday, my telephone rang, and I had not talked to my daughter in almost, or I've actually talked to her, but I had not seen her physically and spent time with her in almost a year. That's the Lord. But when I stopped allowing the devil to torment me with the situation, and I let the power be taken out of it, you couldn't use it no more, church. Stop letting whatever situation is in your life have power over you. I was a drug addict until I said no more and laid it down and give it to God. It took the power out of it. The devil never couldn't hold me down with it no more. What do you have tonight that you've been married to that's weighted you down? That you need? Give it to God. Give it to Him. And stop going to that well and sending down the same problem over and over. That allows the power to be taken out of it, church, and the devil can't use it on you no more. There's no power in something. He's not going to use it. It's not a weapon. You know, Mary comes to Jesus and says, what are we going to do? We're out of wine. Mary didn't answer Jesus. She went to the servants and said, whatever He tells you to do, do it. Jesus didn't tell her He would. He didn't tell her he would use the servants, but Barry knew in the earth realm, whatever God done, it would take the servants to get it done. Whatever God's going to do, it takes me and you. And we got to be involved. How can we, as Christians, and this is a question that the Lord laid on my heart, and I was asked this, said, to prepare for what shall be. Now follow me, church. To prepare for what shall be, if you're still worried about what is, how can you be prepared? If you're constantly looking at where you're at and where you was, how can you move on? My wife's at home sick right now, but I know she's not going to remain sick. I have expectations. When I get home, my wife will be well. He's not blind anymore. Amen. As long as the devil can keep us blind to our circumstances and situations, he will, and he'll use it on. Let's look a little further. And he saith unto them, draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast. You know, they had done through 180 gallons of water. And now Jesus is telling them, you know, when I was reading this story, I was wondering to myself, at what point did this water turn to wine? Was it as they was drawing it, and putting it in the water pot, and walking back up the hill, or down the hill? Which was it? Was it just when the expectation of the governor of the party, that's the person that was the organizer, his expectation was there was going to be wine in this cup? As a servant, they went down there, they were drawing water. So their expectation was water. What do you think they got? Water. Who was expecting the wine? The governor. When they poured that water in there, he says, when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, every man at the beginning doeth set forth good wine, and when men hath well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. This beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee, and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. We have to believe that whatever you ask God, ask him and walk away. Have faith and practice faith. And show faith by you laying the situation down and walking away and giving it to God. That's showing your faith. By you not allowing it to weigh you down and bring misery to your life. That's exercising your faith. That's living in expectation. You know, everything can be taken away from us.
I've been there. Some of it was by not my own actions, but some of my own. But the Lord has begun restoring that because I believe what His Word says.
Amen.
And that's what we must do. Is believe what His Word says. Because there's going to come a time, church, to when we'll be just like the little lady at the office. And we'll have to face the option of, do I do what the Word says, or do I do what the world says? Well, I chose a long time ago that I was going to do what the Word says. Not what the world says. That's what the Lord wants us to do. And those pots, being 180 gallons, you know, they were heavy. And as servants, we can be weighted down with many things. It was heavy to carry. But today, church, whoever's about to offer our nation, whatever, you're weighed down with, whether it's finance, job, whatever, bring it right here tonight. Don't leave here the same way you came in here. That's what the devil wants you to do. Just carry around the same thing over and over and over. Text about it on Facebook and ask everybody to pray about it. But start telling everybody what God is doing, not what you need God to do.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Victory.
Miraculous feats. Maybe you just heard last Jesus. Oh,
Hallelujah.